Welcome to another episode of Scuba Science, the show where we break down scuba diving one scientific fact at a time. Today we are diving into underwater photography. Today we're diving into underwater photography. Whether you are a beginner, you're a scuba diving expert but new to photography, or a photographer but new to scuba diving, I'm hoping to share some insights with you on how to get better results with your underwater photography. I'm very excited about the sponsor for today's episode, and I think you will be too, because today's episode is sponsored by the Underwater Club. The Underwater Club is a fully online underwater photography academy. It's designed to make learning underwater photography easier and fully online. And right now, already participants from 18 different countries are studying and interacting together on this platform. I checked it out myself, and it's actually really smart. It has very short, nice online modules on various topics, and you can study at your own pace. But that's not all. The courses are created by Nicolas Rémy, who is actually an award-winning underwater photographer, and he offers the option to do online Q&A sessions, and you can even have your own photos checked and critiqued by Nicolas himself. So besides studying online, you are getting mentorship from a real award-winning underwater photographer. I made an account myself, and I highly recommend you look into it too, especially if you're looking to get into underwater photography or want to get better. There is a coupon code DiveSaga with which you can get a 10% discount on the Underwater Club, and you can also take a free trial if you're not super sure. But thank you to the Underwater Club for sponsoring this episode of Scuba Science. If you're watching this video, whether you are or are not yet a scuba diver, I'm sure that in your life you've already taken pictures to some degree. Now, taking photos underwater is a whole different ballgame. First of all, light behaves differently underwater, because light coming from the sun needs to travel through all the layers of water before it gets to your lens. Water absorbs color, starting with red first, and then orange, yellow, and so forth. And that is exactly why, if you've already taken some photos without a lot of experience, you will have noticed a lot of your photos tend to look blue or green underwater. Secondly, there is a lot less contrast and sharpness. This is again due to you being in the water, namely because all water has particles in it, and the more particles in the water, the more light has to warp around those particles before it gets to your sensor. This can make your photos look hazy and a little bit unsharp, and so that's another thing that you will have to work for to undo. And of course, you're floating. When we are practicing photography on land, yes, it is important, of course, to keep your camera still, but you are usually grounded, or you may have a tripod. In the water, you are also floating, so that's just another axis of movement that you really have to control to make sure you get the right image. Luckily, with just a few adjustments, all of these problems can be mitigated. Here's a beginner tip for you. If you're really new to underwater photography, I would start with what you have. What you have may either be a cell phone in an underwater housing, you can check out our Dive Volk underwater housing review for instance, or you may already have an action camera. Those are perfectly fine starting points. They may not be ideal for macro photography or anything that's really close up, but before you start getting into that anyway, you should probably start practicing a little wider, and those cameras are perfectly serviceable for that. Next up are compact cameras with an underwater housing. These will typically give you a little bit more control over your focus, your exposure, and your white balance. But whatever you choose in that regard, the key is choose a proper underwater housing. Make sure you know the depth rating of that underwater housing, because not all housings are built equally. And always do a pre-dive seal check after you put the camera into the housing. Now, if you have a good budget to get into underwater photography, you're in a good spot, because underwater photography equipment is not necessarily cheap. On the other hand, I would advise you to not immediately start learning with the most advanced equipment that you can afford. At the end of the day, it's all about composition and lighting, and you can practice a lot of that with a simple, relatively affordable setup. On top of that, if you would flood your expensive setup while you're still learning, then you're back to square one. In my opinion, the most important factor in underwater photography is light. This is already the case for land-based photography, but becomes even more important underwater to help mitigate the challenges we mentioned earlier. Since water tends to filter out the red, orange, and yellow tints in our image, leaving us with a mostly blue and green photo, it is very important to take some steps to counteract this. The most obvious step here would be to stay shallow. If you stay shallow, meaning closer to the surface, the light from the sun has to travel through less water, and so less color will be absorbed. But of course, that does limit a little bit the amount of subjects that you can photograph. Nevertheless, it's a good place to start practicing, and I enjoy my photography where it's shallow and where the light penetrates easily. A second thing you can do, and probably should really consider, is to add a light. You can start very easily with an underwater video light just to practice positioning, but eventually you might want to move to a strobe light. Not all beginner cameras will work with a strobe light, so make sure that you check that when you buy your equipment. Nevertheless, one or two video lights is great to practice with. And lastly, you can bring color back by setting the correct white balance, which is something that you can learn with your underwater photography instructor, or for instance at the underwater club as mentioned earlier. Or you can also use a red filter. I'm not a big fan of red filters simply because they tend to also absorb a little bit of light, meaning the deeper you are, now you're losing color, but you're also losing light by adding the filter, and you're already losing light from being deeper. So it does become a little bit of a challenge, but it is an option. My advice here would be that if you can upgrade one thing, I would go for the light. In my opinion, it's better to work with a simpler camera with less options and even a less performance sensor, but with nice lights, rather than a very performant camera, but no lights. Then there is composition. A good underwater photo doesn't only need to be technically correct, but also needs to have good composition. So here are some beginner tips. My first tip would be get close to your subject. That is not always possible and is definitely not always easy, especially if you're into photographing wildlife. But the closer you can get to your subject, the less water is between you and that subject, the clearer your image will be. Do remember that if you are just practicing with, for instance, an action camera, the focal point of those action cameras' lenses may not allow you to get much closer than 2 or 3 feet. So that is something you're going to have to experiment with. The second composition tip would be to shoot upwards. That accomplishes two things. When you're shooting upwards, you can use the sun as a backlight, which can actually provide really nice and dramatic lighting on your subject. But the second benefit is that the background will probably be just nothing, just nice blue water background, which helps you separate the subject, which you are trying to photograph, from the background. Which does bring me to the third tip, which is to really consider your background. It is very important to make sure that your subject is clearly identifiable in the photo. Most beginning underwater photographers make the mistake of shooting top down. This makes sense. If you scuba dive properly, you are of course more so oriented looking towards the bottom. But shooting downwards means that all of your subjects will be immediately blended in with the bottom, making for a much less interesting image. And lastly, and this is somewhat subjective, but I would avoid centering your subject. You can always fix that a little bit in post by recropping your image, but I would say nothing is more relevant to learn in photography than the rule of thirds. The rule of thirds essentially divides the screen into two horizontal lines and two vertical lines, and the subject should be placed on one of these intersections of lines. This is somewhat subjective and we can argue about composition, but as a good rule of thumb, start practicing by the rules before breaking them. Being a good underwater photographer isn't just about mastering photography. It is also about mastering your diving. And good buoyancy control is probably the most quintessential skill for being able to capture proper photos. You obviously need good buoyancy so that you can stay steady while shooting, so that you can avoid contact with wildlife, and so you can maneuver yourself in a position that aids your composition. Remember as well that the more particles in the water, the less clear your picture will be. Having bad buoyancy and making contact with the substrate is obviously going to cause silt disturbance and obviously a less clear shot. So that means that you, the photographer, could be instrumental in deciding whether the photo is clear or not clear just by how you behave. On top of all of that, please do not forget your diving skills. Underwater photographers are often the first ones to run out of gas because they fail to monitor their gauges. They often go into deco because they fail to monitor their no deco time, and they often lose their buddy because they fail to stay together. Experienced photographers will be able to juggle all these components while also giving some attention to their camera and the result. I would like to make an extra warning here for shooting underwater photography in wrecks or any overhead environments or difficult conditions. If you are new to any specific diving condition, make sure you get thorough experience in those conditions first before adding the camera. Every new diving skill you learn becomes an extra risk factor on top of your photography activities. Becoming a good underwater photographer is a journey, and no matter how good of a diver you are or how good of a land-based photographer you are, chances are when you combine the two activities, your first results are not going to be amazing. I would not worry about getting amazing award-winning shots from day one. I would suggest you just enjoy that journey of getting really good. Just go out a lot and shoot a lot. If you're very new to it, keep it simple. Don't worry yet about lights. Don't worry yet about all the fancy accessories or expensive equipment. Just focus on composition and managing yourself in the water. Make sure you review your photos after every dive and take notes. Keep a notebook of what worked and what didn't. If you're working with a camera that has the ability to adjust settings, consider noting which settings you used for which photo and what the influence of those settings were on that specific photo. Once you have a handle of all that, consider adding one new skill, one new piece of equipment every time, whether that be lights, macro photography, or wildlife photography. One step at a time, and only add one new activity once you've mastered the previous one. Patience is really key here. It's probably a good idea to really master wide-angle photography first. Try to shoot seascapes, which is landscapes underwater, or maybe portraits of other divers, subjects that are easy to photograph, and then progressively move towards close-up photography, wildlife photography, and if you're certified to do so, only then maybe venture into overhead or more difficult environments. A last little pro tip that I would like to share is that it is okay to try to imitate good photos that you've seen. Just scroll through Instagram, follow Dive Saga, find photos that you like, and try to figure out how these photos were created and try to recreate them. You're not stepping on anybody's toes. You're not infringing on anybody's creativity. It is okay to have role models, and it is a great idea to try and emulate styles so that you can find your own. In conclusion, underwater photography is its own little animal, and it is a journey. So I suggest that you start small and you start easy. You can start by becoming a member of the Underwater Club, which is a sponsor of this video, and you can get a 10% discount with the coupon code DiveSaga. I recommend you give it a try because underwater photography does require instruction and mentorship. But if you take it step by step and you enjoy the process, you will surely get great results. We are already in an amazing position with so much accessibility to affordable underwater cameras, editing tools, apps on our phones. It's really amazing what we have thanks to Scuba Science.